Oh, hi, friends. Hey, Brother Mike, back on the Sunday morning podcast. It's 9 o'clock Mountain Time, 9 o'clock in Arizona time, 11 o'clock Eastern. Welcome to the show. I got an interesting Bible study for you today. I'm going to ask you to consider some unusual things about divine healing. I wanted to share it with you today. A couple of quick announcements. Of course, the women's seminar is November 19th. Go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com, for that one. It's going to be a boomer. Sister Julie Andrews, she's my top counselor on the staff at the Deliverance Center, is doing the seminar. It's going to be fantastic. For ladies, you need to be at that one. Broadcast live on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/houseofhealingac. And then on the 25th, I'm having a healing and deliverance service and a seminar on the mysteries of divine healing. I'm doing a preface of it today to give you an idea of some of the things we're going to cover. And then on the 26th, which would be December 26th, I will not be doing my deliverance training class on that Saturday. I'll be doing it a week earlier, so it'll be on the 19th. And please remember that we have two Zoom deliverance services every week, Tuesday and Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock, Arizona time and Mountain time. You can send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com, and I'll be happy to send you the link, passcode, and the ID for the Zoom services. Then Thursday and Friday, we have live services at the Arizona Deliverance Center. Those are broadcast on our YouTube channel plus four other platforms. youtube.com/houseofhealingaz, and all kinds of things for you. Thank you, by the way, for your prayers yesterday at the International Healing Cathedral at Sunny Slope. The crowd turnout was low, but we had some spectacular deliverances. We had healings. One lady got healed of fibromyalgia and chronic right knee pain, plus she got healed of clinical depression. All three of them right in that service, and it was beautiful. We had some spectacular deliverances. Thank you for your prayers and your support. Hey, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about divine healing today. It's a strange subject, and not everybody understands it completely. Let me strike that. Nobody understands it completely, including me, okay? Including me, but I want to share some of the things, some insights into it that I'll be sharing at my seminar this month that are very important. And the confusion around divine healing is spread across all of Christianity, but you can clear up a lot of it this way. Remember that Satan has supernatural powers. And in his ability to affect human beings. And God revealed that for us divinely in the incredible book of Job. In this book, in chapters 1 and 2, and with the advent of Job's three friends, you can see Satan's supernatural power working clearly in the lives of people. The Bible specifically says that Job had his farm laborers murdered by Satan. Lightning killed Job's sheep and his employees, caused by Satan. Satan stole his camels and killed his field workers. And the Bible says Satan did that. Satan killed Job's children with a tornado, once again controlling the weather. Most people don't know that Satan has the ability to control the weather. A lot of people are not aware of that. He also attacked Job with sicknesses. He had boils literally everywhere on his body. The guy was tortured for weeks or months, however long that trial lasted. And then Job sent in his three friends, which he's going to do to you. You know, the Bible says, draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. And as soon as you start that process, the devil will send in your friends. They're not really your friends. They're plants by Satan to destroy your anointing and keep you from drawing closer to God. If you draw nigh to God, he will draw nigh to you. Notice that you have to make the first move. He makes the second move. It's like checkers. You move, the other person moves. You move, the other person moves. You can't play checkers by yourself unless you've got DID or schizophrenia. Now, in the Bible clearly states, when it comes to divine healing, that it is God's will to heal. And the Holy Spirit was trying to illustrate that through the ministry of Jesus. It's God's will that everyone be saved and born again and go to heaven. Okay. 2 Peter chapter 3 says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. 1 Timothy chapter 2 says, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, that there is one God and one mediator between God and man, Jesus Christ the Lord. The Greek word for who will in that verse in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, is thelo, and that means I want to. He wants to have all men be saved, sozo. That's the Greek word for deliverance, sozo. It's used in numerous contexts, different types of context in the Greek text, but it means deliverance, deliverance from sin, from sickness, from hell, from judgment, from death, etc. In Hebrews chapter 2, the Bible specifically says that, quote, through death, Jesus might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. The devil has the power of death. That's the Greek word kratos. It means the dominion. Satan caused death to come into the world, and he did it through Adam and Eve by tricking them into, he stole their inheritance and he stole their rights. And death entered the world, and that's why everyone dies. That's why, barring the rapture, you and I are going to die. And quite frankly, the possibility of us dying pretty slim right now. The end is only a few years away. And it says, after he destroys the devil, it says, who through fear of death were all their lives subject to bondage. The Greek word is dalia. It means slavery. We have all, from birth to death, been a slave of dying. Everything dies. And the dominion or the ruler over the world of death is Satan. John chapter 1, verse 3 says, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's the Greek word luo, and it means to loose or unchain. And that's the purpose that Jesus came to the earth, to destroy or loose all the bondages of the devil, whatever they may be. Sicknesses, sin, demons, death, eternal death, damnation, everything. Whatever the works of the devil are, that's what Christ was sent here to destroy. And there are several other verses in the Bible that explain clearly that it's God's will to save, heal, and deliver. And Jesus' commission from Father in Luke chapter 4 was his quotation of Isaiah 61. It said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The word gospel there is the Greek word euangelion. It means glorious good news. And he sent me to heal the brokenhearted, people who have had their hearts shattered. The Greek word is suntribo. Boom. That's what happened yesterday at our meeting Saturday morning at the International Healing Cathedral, a woman who had been molested by her cousin when she was 6 or 7. And it led to clinical depression over the years. She was completely healed yesterday. And that spirit that transferred from her cousin into her was removed right in the middle of the service. And that is simply the Holy Ghost carrying out the inheritance of the living Christ to heal that woman because she came forward. I went like this in the crowd. I waved her to come forward and stand in the front. And she did. She got up and she came forward. And then she told me what was hurting her. She told me what her problems were, the struggles that she'd had. And she repented. And boop, there she was. She got healed right in the middle of the service. Everyone who does that, you draw nigh to God. He'll draw nigh to you. You confess your sins, which is absolutely required, right? If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that includes removing sicknesses and demons from your body, causing a physical illness, or your mind, causing a mental illness. And that's what happened to that lady yesterday. She got healed of clinical depression. She got healed of fibromyalgia, and she got healed of chronic right knee pain. It happened yesterday morning, and it happens routinely at the Arizona Deliverance Center in Phoenix. So if you come for a visit, or you're on the Zoom, hey, it doesn't matter, or you're on the YouTube, it doesn't matter. The Holy Ghost is not limited by time, space. He's ready to go, big time. Now take a look at this. We notice that in the Bible, and I wrote a book on it. It's a very short book and quick read. It's in the bookstore. It's called Atonement Healing. Atonement Healing. And I bifurcate the healings in the New Testament. These are demonic root issues. These are medical root issues. Not everything is demons. Sometimes you need to be healed. Sometimes you need to be delivered to be healed. Some illnesses and sicknesses and traumas are not caused by demons. They're medical conditions. Some of them are caused by demons and they need deliverance. The problem is when you put somebody on a prayer chain, it goes out to the prayer warriors, and then they all pray for the person's healing, but that doesn't work. The reason those prayer chains are so ineffective is because many of the prayer requests should have been sent out as deliverances, not healings. If a spirit enters your body and causes an illness, the illness can be removed easily when the spirit is removed. In most of the cases, the illness goes with the spirit at that moment. For example, yesterday with this lady I'm telling you about, her clinical depression gone, her fibromyalgia gone, because the spirit was causing the illness. And once the spirits were removed, the illnesses went with them. And that's generally speaking how it works. And so you look through the text and you'll see demonic illnesses, and then you'll see medical issues, right? Pretty clear. For example, the woman from Syria who tracked Jesus down and drove the disciples nuts, trying to get her daughter healed because she knew that her daughter had become infected with a spirit. You see, in the United States, 99% of the churches are grossly ignorant. They don't understand demons and don't want anything to do with them. But back in the day, when Jesus was alive in the first century church, demons were not things that caused people to be shocked. Nobody was confused over spirit. Everybody knew about demons. They knew they existed. and they knew they caused physical and mental illnesses. It was like a routine thing back then. Now it's like, well, what in the world is that? Back then it was common knowledge. And so this mother hunted Jesus down and was stalking him in an attempt to intercede for her daughter who was back home in Syria. And she kept yelling at Jesus so much. She kept saying, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David." She kept yelling at him so much that the disciples tried to get her to shut up. She wouldn't. Then they went to Jesus and told him, "Hey, run this gal off. She won't stop yelling at us." Well, listen, when you draw nigh to God, he will draw nigh to you. And when that happens, the second step happens, you drawing nigh to God, no one will care about that. But when God draws nigh to you, people will recognize it. And then the demons will send bad friends and kooks at the church and naysayers, naggers, and doubters. You will be flooded with them. And that's what happened to the Syrian woman. She was interceding for her daughter, desperate for her to be delivered and healed. And the disciples turned on her. And the people that turn on you the most, many times, are church people. People who don't understand your calling. They don't understand your desires. They don't understand your mission. They don't understand. And what people don't understand, it's human nature. They will nitpick it or criticize it. I've been a counselor for 40 years. I know a lot about people, a lot more than most people. People will naturally criticize something that they don't understand or that they're afraid of. Those two things will generate verbal persecution. So that's what happened to her. The disciples didn't have any compassion for her. They told her to leave. They told Jesus to get rid of her. Hey, you're going to run into that exact same thing. Not at this stage, draw nigh to God, but at that stage, he will draw nigh to you. When he makes his move on you and comes to you, that will trigger the move of the spirits attacking you. And Jesus finally came to her and she said, my daughter is grievously vexed. Now that Greek word there was daimonizomai. It means to be under the control of a spirit to a greater or lesser degree. It should have been translated badly demonized, but it was translated in the King James Bible, grievously vexed. It means that the girl was sick and being tormented by a demon. And Jesus, it says, didn't answer her. And then the disciples said, "Send her away. She's yelling at us." Kradzo is the Greek word. She was literally yelling at them. She was yelling at Jesus for help. And then when the disciples told him to send her away, Jesus then talked to her. Before that, he wasn't talking to her. And I think he didn't talk to her because A, he wanted to see the level of her faith and her perseverance. And B, he wanted to teach the disciples a lesson. So Jesus says to her, "Hey, I'm not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." And she fell down in front of him and said she was worshiping him. And she said, "Lord, help me." Now that's a tremendous pattern for you to follow, is come in worshiping in spite of your illness, your sickness, your disease, your mental illness. Doesn't matter. Temporarily put those aside and come in with praise. Come in with worship. She was worshiping him. Then she asked for a prayer request. That pattern is almost foolproof. That pattern of prayer. Come in worshiping. Then make your requests. Let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ our Lord. There it is. She came in worshiping, and then she made a request. Jesus then tested her faith another step. He said, "It's not appropriate for me to take the children's bread and throw it out to the dogs." Now you say, "Well, that was very insulting." No, it wasn't. The dogs was a common term that Jews used to describe Gentiles, but in this case, it was mistranslated. The King James Bible mistranslated it. It was kunarion, which is puppies. Puppies. In Jewish society, the Jews were considered big dogs, and the Gentiles were considered puppies. There was a gap. Here's the mature big dog. Here's the puppies, the Gentiles. And so Jesus was using common terms of the day. He says, not proper for me to take the children's bread, which is what? Deliverance is the children's bread. You see, you don't want to run around casting demons out of sinners. Okay, on YouTube today, deliverance has now become run of the mill. It's become the flavor of the month. It's become the next big thing, so to speak. And deliverance has become commonplace on YouTube. And you see everybody casting these demons out of everybody. Most of those deliverances end up bad because you cannot have a deliverance ministry and you should not be doing deliverance on people if repentance from sin is not the centerpiece of your deliverance ministry. At hardcorechristianity.com, repentance is the centerpiece of our deliverance ministry. You have to repent. You have to renew your mind. That is required by God and the Bible. We do not do casual deliverances on people. That does not happen. Repentance has to be part of the process for it to be successful. Okay? Win Worley was very successful using the repentance method. Derek Prince, for example, extremely successful using the repentance method. But deliverance is a children's bread. You don't cast demons out of a sinner because they don't have any weapons to fight the demons when they come back. The demons will try and re-enter after you cast them out. Well, repentance and mind renewal keeps them from getting back in. But sinners don't have that. They don't renew their mind. They don't repent of their sins. You just blew some demons out of somebody. Well, those demons are going to try and come back, and in most cases, they get back in. Most of these YouTube deliverances, they're terrible, because they don't require them to repent. They don't require them to renew their mind. There's no system or process set up. And that's the danger of casting demons out of people in parks, on the street, going down to the homeless encampment. We're going to cast demons out of the homeless people today. They're very risky, very risky. Unless you've got a system set up where they can renew their minds and they can finish repenting of their sins. So the children's bread is for Christians. Deliverance is for Christians, not sinners. That's one of our benefits from the atonement. And the woman says to Jesus, that's true, Lord, but the puppies eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. And bang, that did it. Jesus had seen enough faith. And he said, woman, great is your faith. See, he was testing her faith. And your faith is going to be tested too. You're not just going to wake up tomorrow morning, oh, hey, I got the faith of Smith Wigglesworth. That's it. I'm entering my worldwide healing ministry. No, it's not going to happen. Not going to happen. Your faith has to be tested for it to grow. Testing adversity allows your faith to accelerate as you become Revelation chapter 2, Revelation chapter 3, an overcomer. You have to be an overcomer. And she had overcome. She passed her test, the test of faith. And Jesus said to her, listen to this, it's amazing. Be it unto you the way you want it. Same Greek word, phalo. What you want. That's amazing. Her prayer, according to what she wanted, after she passed her faith test, was hers. She was granted it. But if you continue with doubt and unbelief and complaining and griping and moaning, all that stuff wipes out your prayer and steals your miracle. Mark chapter 7, it says when she came home, she found the demon had gone out of her daughter and she had been thrown on the bed. Ballo, Greek word ballo, to throw, like you'd throw a football, like you'd throw a chair in a bar fight. Thrown on the bed. The demon, when he left her, threw her on the bed. And when her mother got home, she was still on the bed, probably sleeping and resting from the ordeal she was completely healed. She was, now that's an example of a demonic root illness. The root illness was demonic, and the cure was deliverance. Had it been a medical issue, the young daughter would have been healed. Deliverance for demonic root illnesses, healing for medical root illnesses. And if you can, through discernment or through your intelligence, investigate that and figure it out, bang, you know how to pray, and then you know how to get them healed. You know how to get them healed. Luke chapter 13 is a famous section of text. You've all read it. This woman comes into the synagogue, and to her utter surprise, the King of Kings is the speaker that day. The synagogue ruler had turned it over to Jesus. Smart move. The Lord Jesus was teaching, and right in the middle of his teaching, he looks down and sees this woman who has kyphosis. You know, kyphosis is a disease that causes the spine to curve forward. Scoliosis is a S shape in the spine. Rheumatoid arthritis is a bent swelling in the spine. And it looks like this woman had kyphosis because it says she was all bent over, bowed over is the King James term. Sunkupto means to bend forward. She bent forward. So, but anyway, who cares? Whatever disease it was, you see in the text that this was a demonic root illness, not a medical condition. The medical's out. This was a demonic root illness. The medical is out. And Jesus called it a spirit of infirmity. You remember that? Yeah, she said, should not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, should she not, whom Satan has bound for 18 years, a demon got into her body 18 years before she was in the synagogue that day. She had had the condition for 18 years. Then, when the spirit was removed from the body, the Bible says she just stood right up, which is literally impossible medically for scoliosis or kyphosis or rheumatoid arthritis. You can't do that. That's not going to happen. Those are incurable medical conditions. Incurable. The reason they're incurable is because doctors and nurses don't understand the spirit world. They don't understand the Word of God. They don't understand demons. They don't understand Satan and all the things he did to Job. And so because they are spiritually ignorant, they are not able to cure many diseases that the Holy Ghost routinely cures, because people know that it's a demonic root illness. Once the spirit is removed, the body instantly or gradually recovers. I've seen it happen hundreds of times over the years. They recover instantly. For example, yesterday at that service, that woman instantly recovered from her fibromyalgia and from her clinical depression. She was instantly healed. She was crying tears of joy. She got up and grabbed the mic and gave a testimony. I mean, it was Holy Ghost impressive. We thank God for it. And Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, should not this woman, who is a daughter of Abraham, meaning she was in the lineage of the father of faith, Abraham, whom Satan has bound. Jesus said Satan had to, so now you've got a demonic root illness. Removing the spirit brings instant recovery in this particular case. Right? Yeah. There were all kinds of healings in the Bible that were not related to demons, correct? For example, blind Bartimaeus. He was blind, sitting on the side of the road, and he started yelling for Jesus like the Syrian woman. Sometimes you got to yell at God to demonstrate your sincerity. Not all the time, obviously, but sometimes. And he started screaming at God. son of David, have mercy on me. You remember the story? It's a spectacular story and a teaching story. You draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to you. So you go first, Father goes second. Blind Bartimaeus went first, then Jesus stood ground. And he said, bring that guy over here. Well, when he did that, all of a sudden everybody that was criticizing him, and again, once understand and know, once you draw nigh to God, and then he draws nigh to you, other people will notice it, and they will start attacking you. Your family, your friends, coworkers, church people, boom, 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 boom. They'll start using you as a speed bag. Happens almost every time. When you draw nigh to God, and then he draws nigh to you, that triggers it off in the spirit world. Red flags going off everywhere. Attack. And they do. And they attacked blind Bartimaeus. They were yelling at him and screaming at him, shut up, go back to your cup. Well, you know, blind Bartimaeus, he'd had enough of his cup. He had a little pottery cup out on the street corner, and he would take in denaries, you know, different coins. He was a beggar, right? And you wouldn't believe what we have today in our homeless camps all around the country, particularly the big cities. Phoenix has tremendous issues with homeless. What happened? Bang. He got completely healed. There was no mention of any demons. He must have had a medical condition that damaged his eyes or something. Could have been a birth defect. And that was it. He was healed. There wasn't any mention of demons. Not everything is demons. So you got to use your discernment to figure out which is which. Is this a medical root or is this a demonic root? And once you make that determination, Your prayers then are laser sharp and to the point, bang, you will see your healings accelerate dramatically. Instead of just throwing somebody on the prayer line without even knowing what you're doing, because you were told to do that and you think it's the right thing, use your discernment, analyze the thing and see if deliverance is needed or if healing is needed. At the service yesterday, I knew and I could see that those were demonic root illnesses in that woman. Fibromyalgia, clinical depression. She got healed. That's right. You remember the story of the panicking father who brought his son to the 9 disciples for deliverance, and it was a failed deliverance session. This is very common. In this particular case, it's very interesting. Mark 9 and Luke 9 have this story itemized. It's really fantastic. It's a tremendous teaching story. Okay. The father comes to Jesus and he says, Master, I beg you, look upon my son. He is my only child. Okay. The father came to Jesus and called him Didaskalos. Didaskalos is the word for teacher. He says to him, Teacher, I beg you, look on my son. He's my only child. A spirit takes him. He suddenly cries out. The Greek word kradzo means to scream. He suddenly screams, and then it tears him. Sparasso is the Greek word. It means seizure. This demon inside the boy would start screaming, and then he would have an epileptic seizure, so to speak. Probably grand mal. He foams at the mouth. The spirit bruises him, and it hardly ever departs from him. And that means that it was a chronic, systematic, chronic medical condition that had a root that was demonic. Then it says, wherever he takes him, he tears him and foams and gnashes his teeth. He gnashes his teeth. That's the Greek word tridzo. He was grinding his teeth while he was having a seizure. And he says he pines away. Okay, that Greek word for pines there is exereno. Exereno means he's wasting away. That means he was dying from malnutrition. And he says, I spoke to your disciples and they should cast him out, and they couldn't do it. Okay. Why couldn't disciples do it? Well, that's a different Bible study. Later on, Jesus told them it was because of your unbelief, and that you had to fast and pray to make sure that your unbelief was completely removed, because these types of powerful demons, they were deaf and dumb spirits. These types of powerful demons don't come out easy, and they're very, very intelligent. So demons like borderline personality disorder, like Herschel Walker used to have, schizophrenia, you know, dissociative identity disorder, these superpower demons that are like they're on steroids, these things do not come out easy. I have as much trouble with them as everybody else does. You've got to get the person who has the demon to join in with the deliverance and repent and fight back with you in order to get these spirits out of people. But notice, this was a demonic root illness, and the child had multiple disabilities, because Jesus asked him, how long ago did this come to him? Jesus was asking him a question because he wanted some key information out of the dad. And the dad said it started when he was a child. A paediathon means it started from infancy. So this looks like a case where the demon entered the womb and then entered the fetus and infected the child before he was born, because he was having seizures, foaming at the mouth, from the time he was an infant. A tiny baby, an infant, paediathon. And then the father asked Jesus, if you can do anything, have compassion on us. So right now you see the peril that this poor dad is in. He's heartbroken over his son. He's in tears. He's hoping against hope that somebody can deliver him. He heard that Jesus could deliver him. He takes him to the 9 disciples. The other 3 are on the Mount of Transfiguration. He goes to them and he says, this has got to be it. These are the number 1 exorcists in Israel. I'm finally going to get my son healed. And then they couldn't do it. This man had lived an entire life with his child in chronic disappointment. Okay, and disappointments are Satan's specialty. He beat Job down to a pulp, not just because of boils, but because of chronic disappointments. His prayers to Jehovah were not being heard. His sacrifices to Jehovah, in his mind, were not working for his children. They were killed. They're not working for him. He's sick as a dog. And then I want you to notice something funny about that Job story. And again, it goes back to the Syrian woman. If you draw nigh to God, when he draws nigh to you, it'll bring out of the woodwork and crawling out from under rocks are these church people or your family members who are going to attack you. They're going to hit you. And this poor father had been hit with everything. He had taken him to numerous exorcists in Israel. He had been fighting for his son's life for years. From the time he was an infant, he and the child's mother had put up with this horrible disability. And it was a multi-layered disability. But Jesus asked him a specific question. That question was very important, because later on, when the disciples came to Jesus, 9 of them, they said, why couldn't we cast them out? He said, because of your unbelief, because this kind only goes out by prayer and fasting. Genea is the Greek word for kind in that verse. Okay? It means generational. So this was a generational spirit that came down through the family tree, hit the kid in the womb, caused him to be born with defects, and then tormented him his entire life. So now he's a junior high or high school, and the kid's still being tormented from a generational spirit. And so these demons that come down through the family tree, they call them deaf and dumb spirits. These demons are super powered. They usually have some form of witchcraft or masonry or Mormonism or false religion or something in the family tree. Somebody was messing around with demons, superpower demons, up the family tree. They come down the tree and start picking people off. And this kid got picked off in the womb. And he had congenital disabilities. Yeah. See, you have to be able to diagnose whether or not the illness is demonic. Right? Before Jesus saw the disabled man at the pool of Bethesda, remember that? There were no demons mentioned in that story. Nothing was cast out. It was just a healing. He apparently had been born with a birth defect. He couldn't walk, probably a spinal condition, and he needed healing. Remember, not everything's demons, but everything requires discernment. Okay, think about what you're doing, analyze it, take a look at the text, see if it fits, and then pinpoint your prayers laser sharp to destroy the works of the devil, which is the purpose that Jesus was born. Jesus was born to destroy the works of the devil. And once that deaf and dumb spirit was removed from that child's body, Jesus had already done his fasting. He had zero doubt and zero unbelief, and demons were completely subject to him. Okay, you and I don't have that level of anointing, so we can't do what Jesus was doing. We do something similar to him, but we'll never be Jesus. We don't have that anointing that Christ had. No one ever did. No one ever will. The deaf and dumb spirit was removed, and then the boy was laying there, totally exhausted. He appeared to be dead. Jesus knew he wasn't dead, and he had already found out it was a generational spirit. He blew the thing out of there and reached over and took the boy by the hand and told him, "Come on, son, wake up. Wake up, dear. Come on." And he lifted him up and then handed him over to his dad, who was in tears. This time, instead of tears of disappointment, they were tears of joy. What you got to remember, you just got to do it. You draw nigh to God. When he draws nigh to you, you are going to get hit. Okay? Some people get hit when they're being drawn in, not normally, because the demons, they don't really think you're going to do anything. You're not going to pray through. You're not going to persevere. You're going to do what you normally do. You're going to fulfill your unconscious goal of being a spiritual loser. They know that. They put that in your mind years ago. But if somebody actually presses through that and really draws nigh to God, the demons will see it, they will counterattack. Then they usually use people to do it. The Syrian woman, Brother Jairus, is out on the street, and they come to him. They said, "Hey, your daughter's dead. There's no point in bothering the teacher anymore." Same Greek word, didaskalos. They called him a teacher. If that's all he is to you as a teacher, you're in some bad trouble. Yeah, he's much more than that. Hey, he looks around at Jesus. He's got a look on his face of sheer terror. His daughter died. "Come back and let's do the funeral." Because you remember, under Jewish tradition and law, you had to be buried within 24 hours. Oops. So there's not a lot of time to be out running around to people raising from the dead or faith healers. They said, "Hey, you got to come back and bury your daughter. She's dead." He turns around and looks at Jesus with a look of horror on his face. And Jesus says three words: "Keep on believing." And he's saying those three words to you today. Did you know that? Yeah, he's saying to you, keep on believing. Revelation 2, Revelation 3, you are an overcomer. You're going to persevere. You're going to keep the faith. You're going to push it. See? Let me explain something to you as I close this morning. The devil's kicked your face in numerous times, and he has tortured your family. He has stolen everything, money, your reputation, your happiness, your peace, your tranquility, your peace of your mind. I mean, there isn't anything he won't steal. Okay, if Job were here, he'd explain it to you far better than I could. He stole everything Job ever had. Just ripped him right off, totally ripped him off. Let me tell you something. That happened to me years ago. My daughter, who led me to the Lord, was in a brain dead coma up at John C. Lincoln Hospital in Sunny Slope. So yesterday when I was in Sunny Slope, it was kind of a homecoming for me at that service. I was really happy to be back there because I hate all the crime and the drugs and the sin in Sunny Slope. And I love Sunny Slope because the hospital up there, God used to save my daughter's life. He miraculously raised her out of a brain dead coma on Christmas morning in 1996, December 25th, 1996. My daughter raised from the dead. And then, of course, it's a long story after that, how she led me to the Lord. I came back to God. I retired from my secular counseling practice in 2005. Then I went into the ministry full-time and in inner healing and deliverance of full-time. So that's a long story cut real short. But let me get to my point. You and I, we got scores to settle. The devil teed off on you. He beat the living snot out of you. He raped you and your family. He stole. He's killed some of your family with ugly diseases like cancer. Ugh, like MS, like, ugh. You take a look at the devil, you can't even conceive the evil of this person. He's off the charts evil. And you took the brunt of it, or some of it. You're a mini Job. You've lost loved ones that you cared about. He killed them. You've had family members or yourself with severe disabilities or sicknesses. He caused it. And now you got a score to settle. We all got scores to settle. I got one. My daughter's been in the wheelchair since 1996. I got a score to settle. How about you? I partially settled my score yesterday at that service. Yeah, I partially settled it on Fridays at the Deliverance Center. I see people healed and delivered. Those are partial settlements. I'm looking for some real damage. How about you? You ready? Yeah. You got any questions or suggestions for future shows? Send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Please be on the YouTube broadcast Fridays and Saturdays. I usually teach on Fridays. Be on the YouTube teaching channel, youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. Also, live Thursday and Friday nights is on my Facebook page, Michael W. Smith. You can catch it here on twitch.tv. Just put in the code HCCADC. Bang, you're there. We broadcast it on Rumble Live. Just put in the code HOHHCC, and that stands for House of Healing, Hardcore Christianity. And then after Thursday and after Friday, we also post them on our other platforms. Vimeo carries it, closed caption. Put in HOHAZ. BitChute carries it, HCCADC. Rumble carries it, HOHHCC. So there's all kinds of venues to catch us. Please remember, if you want to be healed or delivered, you can be healed and delivered over the Zoom Tuesday, Wednesday nights, 6 o'clock Mountain Time, 6 o'clock Arizona time. Please join. Send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. I'll send you the code and you can get on the healing and deliverance service on Zoom. And please send me an email after the Zoom and let me know how many people got delivered and healed while you were on the broadcast, because there'll be several of them. It's quite remarkable what's going on. And it's all based on God's grace and God's mercy. I want you to remember this as I close. I love you. You and me. Yeah. We got scores to settle.